Shalom, everyone. Ethics. So there is a huge gap between the image that we see outside and the image that we are trying really to do. I will try to share with you what we are really trying to do when we fight. And I fought in 6 wars. The last one in Gaza, the one previous in Gaza, I fought in Lebanon. There is a huge gap. I heard so many stories, some of them so, you know, so unreal. We are spending uranium, we are killing babies. 4 years ago, a lady from Austria, hit by shark in Sharm el-Sheikh, shark. Few days later, an official Egypt guy stood up in conference and said, we investigate the case, we found out the Israelis sent the shark. Okay, ethics. Now, when we speak about ethics, we have to start with the framework, with those 8 seconds that we have in the field to make those decisions. To make decision in the field is not like medicine everywhere else, not in university, at home, in the office, you have the time, you can call your friend, you can call the colleague, the rabbi, Rabbi Google, Rabbi Facebook, Rabbi Twitter. Over there, you have 8 seconds. Shoot or not to shoot. Use a tank, call it chopper. And you are very tired. In the field, you are very tired. I carried on my back 3 weeks in the last war, day and night, more than 65 pounds. Some of the soldiers carried more than 180. Now, when you carry something like that on your back, after 4 hours, you're losing half of your brain. Watch that. Your IQ going down by 50%. Now, when you put the helmet, you're almost idiot. And that's the time to make those decisions. So I will start with give you the feeling of those 8 seconds. Then I will share with you our ethics. We have a very unique one. I will bring a lot of examples and videos from the field just to understand the dilemma. And then towards the end, if we have a few minutes, the goal. The Israeli goal is to win. This is not enough. It's not enough. We have to win and to remain human being. And this is much tougher goal, much tougher. So let's start with those 8 seconds. So we have a suicide bomber driving a jeep inside Gaza. He wants to come close on an Israeli bus taking kids to school and blew himself up with the bus. Now, why he using a jeep? Used to be a barrier between the Palestinian area and the Israeli road, canal, and then a wall of sand. There's a reason he's driving a jeep. So he can go down to the canal and climb to the other side. Second problem is facing are the army position, the watchtower. We call it in Israel pillbox. Usually 40 feet height. You have 4 soldiers inside, and they are watching the area. If they see a jeep trying to climb, they start to shoot. So what they are doing? They are doing diversion. Let's say they want to kidnap someone here. So they start artillery here, shooting over there. While the army busy, that's the time. So that's exactly what we'll see here. They start to shoot on the pillbox from the other side of the village. While the soldiers shooting back, that will be the time for the jeep to come close to the barrier, to cross the barrier and hit the bus. So let's see the video. I've seen that video hundreds of times. Every time when I see the guy smiling like he's going to his wedding, and he knows, and we will see that together. In 15 seconds, that guy will be 500 small pieces. And he's smiling like he's on the red carpet to the Oscar. Just to understand the area, we are talking about Israel, a very small country. The distance between the Israeli road here and Gaza, this is Gaza, is a quarter of a mile, that's it. It's a very small country. We are not Massachusetts, Texas, Arizona. That's the Israeli road, and this is Gaza, quarter of a mile. And in between, we will see later the barrier. That's the pillbox, the watchtower, the soldiers up here. They start to shoot on the pillbox on the other side of the village. While the soldiers shooting back, That will be the time for the jeep to come close to the barrier. Can you see the black line? That's the barrier. So that will be the time for the jeep to come close to the barrier, to cross the barrier and hit the bus. But as you can see in the video, the problem is the timing. The bus is here, the jeep's still in the traffic. So let's see what happened. The jeep arrived too late. The bus is 2 miles from the area. So the jeep decided to turn to the left, to enter the village where the bus came from, to come close to a daycare, school, supermarket, and blew himself up inside the village. The commander of the village heard the shooting. He understood that something will happen, but elsewhere, this is diversion. So he took the armored hammer, you know, the huge hammer that we are using, and went out from the village. Now we see a jeep coming in front of him. There is no sign on the jeep, I'm a human bomber. No, this is a regular jeep, it's the right place. I asked the guy later, how did you know that that's the suicide bomber? He said, one, we had 48 hours alert about a green jeep, a suicide bomber. Second, he said, I heard the shooting. One plus one, that's the guy. So he blocked the road here in the center with the hammer, ran away to the side 50 yards with the soldiers, starting to shoot on the jeep to stop the jeep. The problem, as always, are drivers. You know drivers all over the world, nice belly, not in good shape? My driver the same. A guy from my division, 42 years old. Something happened to the driver of the jeep. He couldn't make the way out from the jeep. Something trapped him to the jeep. So he just opened the armor door, it's a very heavy door, and hide after the door. The guy's still alive. It's a miracle that the guy's still alive. But he lost the legs because the door covered him only up to the knees. And see how that kill of TNT, you will see in a few seconds, it's huge amount. 8 seconds. That's the time that you have in the field to make those decisions. Okay, so you can use force, but make sure that you are using force only against your enemy and not against the non-combatants or the innocent. Now, usually, who are the non-combatants? Civilians, kids, women. Now, when we are dealing with an army, when we fight against an army, it's very easy. That guy that wears uniform, soldier, that guy that wears jeans and t-shirt, non-combatant. When we are dealing with terror, they are wearing the same jeans and t-shirt like you, is even taking advantage on the fact that they are wearing the same jeans and t-shirt. Let's see a small footage from Reuters, just to understand the dilemma. Reuters, not an Israeli reporter. We have here a terrorist on the sweatshirt. Come on, Bensi, this is not a terrorist, he's wearing casual. Any idea why that guy is a terrorist? Can you see the gun here in the side, Kalashnikov? Let's see what happened to the gun in the minute that the guy is on the stretcher. One, two, and from now on the guy is non-combatant. Now the answer to that question is as follows. If you have a doubt, no doubt, don't shoot. Again, if you have a doubt, don't shoot. Even though you're taking risk, what is the risk? Maybe is, take the risk. Take the risk. Make sure when you use force that that's the enemy. Think is not enough. You have to know that that's the enemy. So that's the second. So the first one is force. You can use force only to accomplish the mission. The second one, make sure when you're using force that you know that that's the enemy. And the third one, and that's the most complicated one, dealing with collateral damage. What is collateral damage? Let's say that we have a car 5 minutes from here with a terrorist inside. We know his name, that's the guy. We have a chopper on there, and the chopper can basically hit the car with a laser rocket. But the pilot says that inside the car, 5 kids with the terrorist. Shoot or not to shoot? So this is collateral damage. I am not trying to hit the kids, I'm trying to hit the terrorist. But I know that if I will kill the terrorist, I will kill the kids. Only in proportion to the immediate threat. What I know about the terrorist now. If I know from the intelligence that the guy now has ammunition belt on himself, and he's on his way to one of the schools, malls, in, you know, in the city to blow himself up, I will shoot. Also, I will kill, unfortunately, 5 kids. But if not, listen carefully, even though I know that that guy killed yesterday 10 Israelis, And 3 weeks ago, 5 soldiers. I won't shoot. The pilot is not a judge. He's not trying to punish someone for something they did in the past. He's trying to avoid terror in the future. And if you have collateral damage without immediate threat, don't shoot. Let's see a video to understand that it's not easy. So we are in Gaza. We have a pickup truck with 2 terrorists and few rockets inside. Can you see the pickup? Okay. So the pickup is here. The choppers are not here. Very dangerous to the choppers to come close to Gaza. So usually the chopper is 4 or 5 miles from the area. So the video is not from the chopper, the video is from the drone. Unfortunately, Israel is one of the leading in the world in drones. We have drones from that size up to Boeing 767 as a drone. And I assume that next year we'll have the third generation drones like that. They can go down to tunnels, can enter windows. Yes, I'm serious. Why I say unfortunately? You know how much money, effort, human talent we put in those stupid industries to produce those stupid drones? And if we can use that resources, those resources, to find cure for cancer, we'll be in another place. But we are living in the Middle East, we have to do that. Okay. So the drone is here, the chopper over there, and the chopper got the clearance to launch the rocket. Now, when I say got the clearance, it's a whole procedure. Sometimes 10 minutes. We went through the procedure. So the chopper launched the rocket. Takes to the rocket between 20 to 30 seconds to make the way, 4 or 5 miles. While the rocket on the air, the pilot following the pickup with the laser, that will be the point where the rocket will hit. But while the rocket on the air, the guy decided to go under a building. So the rocket on the way, and the guy's under a building here in the left side. What I know about that building? Nothing. Can be a daycare, school, family with 10 kids, I don't know. But the rocket over there, you cannot call back the rocket, no. Come on, hey, home, please, baby. No, no way. So what we are doing with the rocket, we are taking the rocket to the side and hit the ground to avoid collateral damage. You can see here, the rocket is not the big cross, it's the small one. So the pilot finds out that the guy is still under the building. He is aiming the rocket to the side, to an open field. And 1, 2, 3, 4, here, hit the ground. Now, it happened hundreds of times. Why we are doing that? We are not doing that for the media. The media will ever say that we are killers, murderers, criminals, like what happened today in Gaza. You know, I spoke yesterday and 2 days ago with the commander of battalions on the fence. The story is outside, and what we are going inside, it's so, you know, the gap is unbelievable. This is not a demonstration of civilian people coming to demonstrate. Because if it used to be the case, we will give them to do the demonstration. They are all the time throwing grenades. They are all the time throwing rockets. They are all the time trying to hit the soldiers. Thank God, by the way, 95% of the grenades are bad grenades. They are not, you know, bombs. So they look like grenades. It comes to them, nothing happened. But this is a violent stuff. They try to cut the fence, to enter the area, to put explosive and to run away back. This is not an innocent people coming to make a demonstration. And even though, no one can give the order to shoot, no one, unless the commander of battalion say, okay, I checked the guy, you have to shoot. First, use gas. If the gas doesn't help, you can shoot, but not on the guy. You can shoot in the side. And only after those 2 steps, the third one will be, okay, try to hit the legs. And that's only in the case that the guy is someone that wants to come to the fence and throw something or cut the fence or shoot on the soldier. Come on, the story is outside. Yes, we are shooting all the time. This is nonsense. Nonsense. Really nonsense. So let's go back. Why we are doing that? One, for them. They want collateral damage. For them, they will gain much more support from the community. Fanatic organizations all over the world, not only in Israel, they need support of the community. And if we are killing, you know, kids in Gaza, they will get much more support. They want it. This is one. Second, for us, I don't want to be the one to kill a kid or parent woman. You know, I fought in six wars. I killed people. When you kill someone, you're not doing a party. This is nonsense in the movies. You kill someone. You have to kill him to protect the country, fine. But if you kill a kid or pregnant woman, you will carry them on your shoulders and in your soul till you will die. The American Army. I speak a lot in that. Next week I speak in West Point again. They are suffering today from a syndrome by the name suicide syndrome. You know that. Soldiers coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan commit suicide. Numbers. Last year, the U.S. Army lost 428 soldiers from veterans from Iraq and Afghanistan. This is a huge number. And you have to do a lot with that one. When you are coming back from the field, you are not leaving anything over there. You bring everything back home with you. And if you destroy a village or kill a kid, you will kill that kid the rest of your life. So we want to avoid it. This is not for the media. The media will say that the same stories. Now, when you drive a tank in an L Street, in the right side you have a building, nothing to do with the cannon. In the left side, the same story. If you have an ambulance in the front, they just block the tank. They even try to hit the first tank just under the ambulance. They have a pile of dynamite here, and you can see in a few seconds the guy tried to hit the first one. He did it too early, but if you have some more patience, if you wait 15 seconds more, you will hit the tank. What's the commander of the tank when he goes out from the narrow street, turning to the right, an ambulance, what he should do in those 8 seconds? His mission is to take the unit and to cross the village. First question, are we using force to accomplish the mission? The answer is yes, that's the mission. Second, you see an ambulance. Do you know that that's the enemy? Yes or no? No. And if you have a doubt, no doubt, don't shoot. Quite simple. Don't. Kids. You know, they are using kids everywhere. I've seen it in Gaza, I've seen it in Judea and Samaria, I've seen it in Lebanon. When I speak with U.S. officers, they are telling me that when they enter the village in Afghanistan, everyone is running out from the village, not in our case. In our case, they're running out not from the village, to the street. That's the best show in town. And among the crowd, you can see a guy with anti-tank rocket, a guy with a gun. Let's see again that one. Inside one of the villages. Everyone is out. That's the best show in town. And among the crowd, a guy with anti-tank rocket, a guy with a gun. Now, if I will use a tank here, I will kill, you know, 10 guys. So what we are doing, we are sending snipers to high buildings before we enter in the area, and they try to hit only the guy with the rocket, only the guy with the gun. To do it here on the sidewalk, it's tough. A lot of people here. The best time to do that when the guy crosses the street. So what they are doing, they grab a kid in one side of the street, run him to the other side, and throw the kid in the other side. And my sniper is, again your name? Ricky. Half mile from the area. You won't shoot. This is not a stationary target. This is a moving target. The kid is waving with the leg. Slight wind, you hit the kid. You can see it here. So they hear that we are coming. The guy tried to grab a kid. And the kid is yelling, leave me alone. I'm afraid. Leave me alone. Okay, so he left the kid. Took another one. Running to the other side. Now, Ricky, my sniper, he won't shoot. So he's running to the other side, and so they came to the other side. Why they are doing that? You know why? Because they know something that most of the world don't. They know that when it comes to collateral damage, for us, it's a big issue. Because if we are really killing babies, what's the point to grab a kid? I'm wondering what will happen today to someone in Damascus running with a kid in the middle of the road, in Homs, in Yemen. They know the truth. They know the truth. This is a photo that actually ended the last war. In Israel, in the IDF, when we want to attack an urban area, no matter it's a town, a village, a neighborhood, the procedure is as follows. 48,000 advance leaflets coming from there. We are coming to this area. Please leave the houses. You can use those roads, go to those schools, you have food over there. 24 hours in advance, we have a phone call. We have a unit in Tel Aviv, they call the families. Hello, we are coming, leave the house. 5 minutes per hour, take another phone call. We even use text messages. You know, it's unthinkable to an army to tell your enemy in advance when and where you are going to attack. Why we are doing that? To avoid collateral damage. So they left the houses, but they left also a very nice present to us. There are only three reasons why we are destroying houses during the war. Three. One, if they are using the house as a strategic point to shoot. Second, headquarters. How do you know? It's quite simple. I have on my computer in the army, every time that communication goes out from the house, a green line. If I have 200 green lines an hour, this is a headquarter. So second, headquarters. And third, if that house has an enter to a tunnel or a bunker with rockets. Those aren't the only reason. We are not destroying houses as punishment. We are not destroying houses because we want to destroy houses. So even if you want to destroy a house, the same procedure. 48,000 events, leaflets coming over the house. We are coming to destroy house number 48. Please leave the house. 24 hours in advance, we call the family. 5 minutes later, another phone call. So in the first week, it works, they left the house. In the second, they understand the procedure, and every time when we call them 5 minutes prior to the attack, instead of running from the house, they force or call the neighbors to come to the barbecue on the roof. So we are 5 minutes prior to the attack, and you can see from the drone that the roof is packed. Now, according to the law, the Geneva law, you can shoot, you get three alerts. We said no. We invented a new procedure. And the procedure is knocking on the roof. So we invented the procedure knocking on the roof. Knocking on the roof. We said to the aircraft, wait. We sent the chopper with a laser rocket. Very, very accurate, but the damage to the house is just a small hole. And the chopper launched the rocket to the empty corner of the roof. Now people understand that we are serious. 2 meters from you, you see a rocket. People start to run away. We waited with the drone till they left, not the roof, but the building. And only when we found out that everyone left the building, the aircraft got the 3 clearance to destroy the house. So let's see the procedure. Here, you can see here people running to the roof. Can you see them here running? Hello? Most of them staying on the right side. So the chopper launched the rocket here. That's the chopper. Now people start running back and forth. We are waiting. We want to see them leaving the house. That's the entrance of the house. So the drone makes circles so that the house turns around. But that's the entrance. So let's see. Someone left the house. Someone came back. No, we want to see 15 guys leaving the house. Again, someone left the house. Someone else came. No. Now the group starts going down, and you can see them here leaving the house. Here is the group, and the roof is clear. And only when we found out that everything is clear, the aircraft got the clearance to destroy the house to avoid collateral damage. You know, I mention all the time the term terrorist, and sometimes people tell me they are not terrorists. They are freedom fighters. I want to draw a clear line between a terrorist and freedom fighter or a soldier. Freedom fighter or a soldier, when he fight, he tried to hit the other soldier or the other freedom fighter. Terrorist, when he's doing something, in purpose, he want to kill civilians. The guy that entered the Twins here, 9/11, he has any idea that this is a Marine base? No, he knows that he will kill 3,000 Americans, civilians. He's a terrorist. I will give you another example, my base. I have a huge base, division. I have 20,000 soldiers, 300 tanks. It's a huge base. We are very, very close to Gaza, 2.5 miles. In the last 16 years, they launched more than 16,000 rockets from Gaza over the border to Israel. How many of them hit my base till the last round? The answer is zero. Why they have to waste a rocket against the army while they can use the same rockets against the kid guard in Israel? They are terrorists. They are terrorists. When they will understand they want to fight with the army, this is another story. Today, they want to hit kid gardens, they want to hit civilians in Tel Aviv, in Sderot, whatever. And remember the goal, and the goal is not an easy goal, to fight, to win, and to remain human being. And this is not easy. This is not an easy goal. This is a 365 days of war with the soldiers to make sure that they are still sensitive. You cannot come to the soldiers a week before the war and say, come on, guys, let's be sensitive, come on. It doesn't work. This is 365 days, a mission, all the time to speak about it, to make sure that they are sensitive, to make sure that they know the rules, to make sure that when they fight, they understand it. And this is not an easy task, not an easy thing. Thank you very much.